Connie Martinson Talks Books. The book today is about a man you may not have heard of. You know the name Max Sennett, but do you know the name Thomas Ince? He was Hollywood's independent pioneer. And that's the title of this book that the University of Kentucky, which is doing many wonderful books on film and filmography. It has been written by my guest, Brian Taves. Welcome, Brian.
Thanks so much, Connie.
And truly a fascinating book, Thomas Ince. And you begin, which is interesting, his death. He has been on the boat of Hearst. He has been, and he himself had a large boat. It wasn't just a rowboat. He was now in his 40s, and it was 1924.
Indeed, so many people actually know Thomas Ince for his death, not his life, not his films. There have been rumors going around for years, and particularly a film was made about a dozen years ago called The Cat's Meow, claiming that Hearst somehow was jealous of Charlie Chaplin's friendship with Marion Davies, and Hearst was running around with a gun, and somehow Ince was the unlucky recipient of a bullet. And all of this, Hearst somehow managed to cover up. And actually, the Ince family accepted it all. I can go into more details, but I think it sounds on its surface rather absurd. And yet this...
Well, I think because of Fatty Arbuckle. I think there were a couple of scandals around. So if someone in big Hollywood died, it wasn't, maybe they had overworked. Maybe they had had terrible indigestion or heart failure. They had to have been part of a scandal, not the case.
Well, and Hearst, of course, had many enemies. And this, when Ince became ill on Hearst's yacht, this gave an opening to Hearst's enemies to suggest, well, things may not have been properly going on. And Ince himself, the very year before, had made a movie about yellow journalism. Yeah. And some reporters took exception to such a portrayal of their profession. So Ince was not too highly regarded by reporters at that particular moment. Yeah. So it wasn't a good time in a variety of ways.
Now, it's interesting. Thomas Ince comes from an English acting family who had come to America. And he started early, he and his brothers.
Yes, they had three brothers. They all became film directors. The two of his brothers, John and Ralph, also were actors. And they had all, the other brothers all had notable careers in Hollywood. Yeah. But it was really Thomas Ince who proved to have this unique ability that allowed him to create the role of the movie producer for the very first time.
Yeah. He begins being an actor in New York, though. And then, as I started, there was great turmoil because the Thomas Edison people were suing people who were making movies, claiming they were stealing his invention.
Well, first the Ince came from the stage, and then first he was hired by a movie company, and they said, "Well, we better get it out of here, Edison and company, or on our tail." And so they went to Cuba to film a variety of films, including a number with Mary Pickford. And it was, this was wintertime in New York. Cuba was bright, sunny, and pleasant. You had these beautiful Spanish backgrounds. Audiences loved these films. And from a practical standpoint, Ince as well realized the value of locations shooting. And that would become part of the key to his whole career.
Yeah. He comes out here, meaning we're here in Los Angeles, and he starts to work as an actor, and then he starts to realize these two reelers, there's got to be more than that.
Yes, he did not last very long as an actor. He recognized he didn't have the makings of a leading man, and he realized directing was the way to go.
Mm-hmm.
And he managed to convince Carl Laemmle and some of the other leading producers to let him have an opportunity. And the amusing part is when he arrives in Los Angeles, a small studio in Echo Park today, he finds that it's very ramshackle. And then painted on the window is a scene of some birds in flight. And this is supposed to be for a moving picture. So initially his thought is, oh no, how am I going to manage to make movies when they've already, that's the conception of what a set should be.
Well, he does go on to build a studio out in Santa Monica, or a little bit east of Santa Monica. And it was really quite something because he would have all five different set studios going up in one studio.
They first acquired some land north of Sunset and Pacific Coast Highway today and continued expanding those holdings, and it became known as Inceville. And just it grew in every direction. So you had inland areas to shoot westerns, they would build European villages. You had from different countries, you had some Japanese coastline, you had a ship anchored offshore for a pirate story. You had literally everything springing up.
And Ince loved writers. And he thought stories had to be more realistic, not just pay the rent. I can't pay the rent. This had to be really, what did the person in the audience identify with?
That was a constant throughout Ince's career, was the importance of realism. That was part of the reason he moved to Inceville. When he first came out to California, he realized not only was this artificial studio in Echo Park basically useless, but they had the opportunity to hire a circus, the 101, with real cowboys and Indians. And Ince recognized that movie audiences would appreciate seeing actual Indians, Native Americans on the screen, real cowboys.
Oh, you have a funny story here about the Indian chief coming to him and saying, we want to get paid $3 a day, not $2. And he goes on about how wonderful these people are and everything. And the chief finally says to him, in other words, we're worth that $3.
They told him, and you know, what a great producer you are. You handle things so well. Because he, as Native Americans at that point, were under government supervision. So he had, Ince had to report what was going on to ensure everything was A-OK. And the tribe working said, you know, we think you can give us $3 instead of $2. And they told Ince all these various virtues he had. And finally he said, you know, if with all these skills, if you can't make more than to give us the $3 a day, you need to try another profession.
Yeah.
And he realized, okay, they've talked me into it.
And at that point, he had a lot of people from New York coming out. The one that was interesting to me, because it was a friendship that then got a little rocky because of money, William S. Hart.
Yes. They had been friends back in the days when both of them were on stage before Ince was married.
Yeah.
And so they knew one another, and they had spent some months in a very cold apartment in the New York winter. Finally, they ran out of money and had to go their separate ways. And then almost a decade later, Hart came out to see Inceville. And Hart was on the stage at the time. He had not made films before, but he immediately recognized the potential for Inceville to really, at that time, have a revival of the Western.
Yeah.
Ince's Westerns beforehand had concentrated on these elements of authenticity, but he had not really created a Western star.
Yeah.
And that was the thing that was new. Here with William S. Hart, you had a Western star that brought a new type of persona, the good guy who had once been bad, you know, who proves himself to have a heart of gold, but nevertheless never quite fits in with civilization.
But it goes on a few years and suddenly the audience loves William S. Hart.
Mm-hmm.
And William S. Hart discovers as an agent who says, what are you working for this man for $2,000 a week? We can get you $7,000.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes to break his contract. I mean,
right.
It wasn't just, and he's furious that Ince will not break the contract.
And then meanwhile, Hart wants Ince to pay his taxes and it becomes, it's one of those classic situations where two friends have a complete falling out. They go to litigation and eventually they go their separate ways. The irony is, and this occurred with a couple other Ince stars that left the fold, they are actually did better under Ince's guidance
mm-hmm.
than they did with subsequent producers guiding their career.
Well, Ince knew how to make a star. Mm-hmm. And the person who did respect it was Charlie Ray, or mm-hmm. Charles Ray.
Mm-hmm. Who was the James Stewart, we might say, of an earlier day, the naive lad who is coming of age, seeing to a greater degree mm-hmm. what's going on around him. And he had a perfect role. Americans loved this kind of picture of this young man from teenager to boy to man. And he decided he wanted to be a serious star. And well, unfortunately, Charles Ray lost his shirt, lost really everything he owned. And he came back to work for Ince.
Yeah.
And this is a pattern. For instance, William S. Hart's director, despite the acrimony between Ince and Hart, also came back to work for Ince.
Yeah.
So a lot of people come and go, but they keep coming back to Ince.
You know, it's interesting how the head of a studio can set a pace, can set an emotion of people who like to work for him.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there was a man named William T. Orr, I don't know if you know that name, who was at Warner Brothers TV. People worked for him for less than they could earn elsewhere because he made it fun, but he also did good work.
Mm-hmm. And that was clear with Ince. He was very loyal to his workers, and they were very loyal in turn. And if someone became ill, he kept them on the payroll. It was like a huge extended family. When a baby was born to someone or to a spouse of someone in the that worked at the Ince studio, a huge celebration was held.
Then he buys the land and builds the studio in Culver City. I mean, reading the book, is really, how did L.A. become Los Angeles?
Yes, and Inceville, as enjoyable as it was you know, just spread out all over, and it was also not too good in terms of potential fire hazards. And Ince was looking towards some land being offered in Culver City, and there was things seemed to be falling in place. Then there was a terrible fire at Inceville, and it was actually not so much a matter of structures burning down, but their library of 300 scenarios of movies to be made. That they could not afford to lose.
The coup, the little star on top, was when he bought Hollywood Lab.
Mm-hmm.
And now he not only was making the films, he could make the copies that would then be sent out.
He actually built two studios in Culver City, both of them being used today. And he was indeed very wise about these kind of business investments, finding the right location, as you say, integrating the possibility to, you know, make the lab part of the facility. So that would be a reduce out other expenditures.
Yeah. And it changed because he also became the distributor as well as a result. But what's fascinating is how you tell me in this book, the financial part, that going from being an artistic creator, he now becomes a mogul in a way, an independent producer. And as a result, he has to arrange for the money.
Ince was at one time and the same time both the man who figured out how to make American movies an industry, to plan ahead, to prepare all of the scripts, to have all of the shots broken down, to know what props, what costumes, everything you would need for each day shooting, what extras you would have on hand.
No time wasted.
Right. And they were taking a little look from at Henry Ford's assembly line ideas. And that helped to create the American studio system as we know it. At the same time, for those who wanted to keep their own independence, that became a constraining factor. And that was what was plaguing Ince's later years. He wanted to stay an individual to choose the pictures he would make.
Yeah.
And it was becoming more and more difficult to get money, to arrange distribution.
Yeah. I thought it was interesting where you quote that he borrowed $90,000 from the Bank of Italy, and then he borrowed $200,000 from them another time, all of which was what became Bank of America.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The, part of the situation was to arrange financing, to find banks who would agree to lend
at 7%.
Right.
Yeah.
For a picture that would was in the process of about to shoot based on the script with collateral of some finished pictures, and that was in turn paid off once movies finished their distribution. And so it was a constant cyclical process.
Brian, I kept, as I'm reading it now, I've read the first part where he has died and a young man, and I thought, good heavens, how did he sleep at night?
Mm-hmm.
But now the other side of this is Brian Tavis doing something else. You give me every one of the scenarios of the movies he made. And I was thinking, again, kids who are going, taking a writing course, either at school or college or theater, you've given them all the food for writing.
Well, thank you. I saw about 200 surviving Ince films, almost every single one that's still around. And it gives one a sense of what type of themes Ince was interested in exploring. For instance, I discovered that towards the end of his career, he was especially interested in the changing position of women in American society.
Ah, her and, reputation.
Right. No one had ever mentioned this before.
Yeah, and here's one of the writers.
Oh, that's Thomas and Eleanor Ince. And I was so pleased to find out that Eleanor was a key player in the the company. And both, she was someone that he went to when he needed business advice. She would help go choose locations. She would look up stories. She spoke French and read French. She would do historical research. She never actually put her name on a movie, but you can see she's a guiding force in terms of getting the studio going.
And the people in this photo are?
On the far right there is Bradley King, who is one of the discoveries in my research. She was Ince's most active screenwriter in the 1920s. She took the name Bradley King. That was not
her
the name
de
she
plume.
Was born, right?
Yeah.
Very much. And she was incredibly prolific. And this was a particular film that became central because of that question of the statements about Ince at the time he died. she was writing a film on yellow journalism.
Yeah. And she wrote a good deal with a man named Talbot. Yeah. Who you also did another book about.
Right. That was part of how I discovered Thomas Ince was in my book on Talbot Mundy.
Yeah. Well,
here you can see Mundy, Ince, and Catherine Tingley, leader of a Southern California Theosophical community.
Yeah. Now, your role as an archivist for the Library of Congress, where do films fit in? I know you've had a cold, and we'll tell our friends in the audience, you can't fight it. anyhow, where do films come into the Library of Congress?
Eleanor Ince wisely kept the films after her husband's death.
Mm-hmm.
The company officials wanted to get rid of them. They were like, you know, these are out of date.
Yeah.
And especially once sound had come in, like, who's going to look at silent movies? Eleanor was the one who was wise enough, both for the memory of her husband, and she was a very far-seeing person. She kept the company papers, but especially the films, tried to find room for them at archives, and even before archives would take them, she was still hanging on to them, preserving them as she could.
As you read and all of his screenplays there, the ones that went from two reels to finally, what, 10 reels?
Mm-hmm.
Were you tempted at all to say, maybe I should become a producer? Maybe I should take this over, write a screenplay?
Ince was looking towards the kinds of properties that would be relevant for his time. And that has helped give them an immediacy today so that they don't date nearly as much as so many silent films of the time. For instance, one of the aspects I was quite surprised to discover was the first films with Asian performers playing Asian roles were made by Thomas Ince. Sessue Hayakawa, whom we know from Bridge on the River Kwai, got his start at the Ince studio, and Ince was making a whole series of starring vehicles with Japanese themes. This was the first time any Hollywood studio had thought, well, we can cast actual Asian actors in such roles and instead of just putting our white players in makeup.
Yeah, and later it is Cecil B. DeMille who takes over the studio in Culver City and calls it Cecil B. DeMille Studio. Yeah.
That was customary. Everyone takes, you know, takes what went before them.
What I did think was cute is the ads for the film, which people can see in the book, you really have quite a few of them, an Ince punch. And he was sure about putting his name at the top of those ads.
Ince realized the value of creating a name brand because he was independent, remember, he wasn't just working for one company, he was going to work for a series of companies. So the only thing he had to promote himself was Thomas Ince, that people would know, well, a Thomas Ince production represents quality. So he put that name there, and that was that was a key to bring in audiences, whether it was a film distributed by Paramount, by First National, or another company.
Yeah. Or if it was, because he was one of the first to make films about the Civil War.
Yes.
So to have the South as well as the North, but the funny part to me is when he did something that had a lot of extras, and he said to his friend Max Sennett, hey, you can make a comedy on the side with these guys.
They were very good friends, Ince and Max Sennett. And indeed, that at that period was the 50th anniversary of the Civil War. And so many people from the conflict were still alive. It was not uncommon to meet veterans. And it both telling stories of those days and of looking back through the eyes of the veterans. So this was a particular genre that we've lost track of since that day, but it was a very major part of filmmaking output in that period, 1911 to 1915-16.
How did you happen to get with the University of Kentucky? Because they also did a wonderful book on Mankiewicz.
Yes, they were one of the first presses I approached, and they, when I was about halfway through this, and they expressed interest, and fortunately they continued to express interest as I worked my way through it, and that turned out to be a really perfect alignment.
Because it's really, it's terrific as a history of Hollywood and film. It's also very good for anybody in a business course. I mean, you've hit a lot of different areas with this one book.
Well, the Ince papers gave all of this wonderful information on the cost, the grosses of each film, who we were paying in the company, how much the overhead was each week, and so had this absolutely wonderful and very exceptional amount of financial data.
And
to work
will
with.
You autograph my book, Brian?
Sure.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier or articles we've written. And you can also link into YouTube that carries, the show will be there in a few weeks, all of the past programs. But support your local library. Because without libraries like the Library of Congress, people would, if you don't know your history, you're doomed to repeat it. If you do know it, you can improve upon it. So whatever you do, support your library, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.